last. I'm the rector of this university. Welcome to everyone, and especially to the representative of the Danish embassy. Thank you for coming. And of course, welcome Jan Gehl and Birgitte Zwerre. It's a pleasure to have you here. I know you are traveling a lot and you have a lot to do, so even more thanks for coming, especially to Jan Gehl. Actually, this is our largest lecture room at this university. I'm sorry for any inconvenience caused to you, but on the other hand, I'm proud that so many people are interested in what we are doing. But we are expanding, and next year we will have more space for interesting people like Jan Gehl, and maybe he will come once more. So I only say welcome to you, and let's welcome the father of humanistic urban planning. As I read that you, Jan Gehl, once called Jane Jacobs the grandmother of humanistic planning. So we are all your sons and your grandchildren in terms of humanistic urban planning, and hope to learn a lot from you, not only from this wonderful book. We had the honor to issue as a first time in German language, and also learn a lot from your lecture you will give to us. Enjoy the afternoon, enjoy the book, and enjoy the lecture. Thanks for coming. And now Anton Falkeis will give a short introduction. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, also very warm welcome from my side, dear Mr. Ambassador, dear Jan, dear Birgitte, it's dear colleagues and friends. It's a really great pleasure to have you all here, and we're speaking about if the space is too small and we get another space next year. So I mean, the idea was that we have a next book next year. So please, Jan, could you start right away? Thank you. Yeah, Leben in Städten, the German version of How to Study Public Life, published by Birkhaus as part of the Edition Angewandte, we're going to be presented today. And it's a great pleasure to now introduce the authors of the book, Jan Gehl and Birgitte Zwerre, with whom I had the honor to work on this German edition. I try to make it very brief because we are actually running late because of flight delays. You know, there's a little bit of fog and Vienna is a little bit, some problems on the airplane. So, because otherwise we can spend the whole lecture just introducing Jan and Birgitte. So, Jan Gehl, he's a co-founder of Gehl Architects and held a partner position until 2011. He currently works as a senior advisor and continues to research through his books and lectures over the course of his career. He has published several books, including Life Between Buildings, City for People, New City Spaces, Public Life, New City Life, How to Study Public Life, and most recently, People, Cities. He's a honorary fellow of the Royal Institute of British Architects, the AIA, the RAIC, and the PEI, and so on and so forth. Birgitte Zwerre is responsible for book publications and is a key researcher within Gehl Architects. She takes a culturally analytical approach to the physical environment, and she is sort of specialized in urban spaces in suburban contexts. Birgitte is also the coordinator of internal ongoing education, is actively involved in masterclasses and workshops, and is the co-author of the latest Jan Gehl Gale book entitled How to Study Public Life and Sodomin, the co-author of Leben in Städten. She's also an associate professor at Denmark's Technical University and a guest lecturer at various universities. Very well welcome. We are living in an urban age. Never before in history, cities have been that successful, and never before in history, they have been in such a competitive relationship to each other. Urbanization ratios up to 83%, what we can find in Latin American countries, show how effective cities are in absorbing population growth. Consequently, cities have grown far beyond their original definition and creating communities meeting in public spaces. But how do we manage to accommodate a growing urban population in a way that is sustainable, equitable, and inviting? Jan Gale and Gale Architects have been investing, let's say now more than 50 years of passion examining this question. When starting off his research in the 1960s, only a few urban designers were thinking about designing cities for people. We already heard about the grandmother Jane Jacobs or Christopher Alexander and William White. With this, he is one of the pioneers in this field. Studying city life and understanding the factors that enable change are also a passion shared by Birgitte Swar when co-authoring the book. And I truly hope that the book at hand will not only be a role model for best practice in urban planning, but also an inspiration to act. Thank you for coming, and please, Jan, we had a little bit changed. So Jan will start the lecture and Birgitte will afterwards talk about the book. Thank you for coming.
I will speak English. And I'm very sure that the English I can speak, you can understand. I can only speak English as my second language. I can only speak quite slowly. And I only know 300 words. So you'll be fine, I hope. I can see my monitor is down here. And I changed the slides down here also, I guess. Can you still hear? This is it. Okay, Birgitte and I has warmed up for this trip. Actually, we warmed up all last week in Moscow, where they published the book 4 days ago. It was a very impressive affair, very Russian also. But of course, the German language book came out much earlier than the Russian. So you beat the Russians this time. Could I ask for a volunteer to operate this one? A student? Will it be Birgitte? Yeah. Yeah, you may know what it's all about. Yeah, somebody else take some pictures. Who can take pictures? Okay. Yeah, we are ready to go. Going to Moscow to publish this book. Of course, it was a fantastic joy for myself to see what has happened in Moscow. Because first time I was in Moscow was actually 5 years ago. And at that time, Moscow was completely horrible. I've never seen a place worse than Moscow in 2012. And now it's 5 years later. But first I show you how it was in 2012. This was just an ordinary little friendly neighborhood street. The city was completely invaded by motor cars. There were cars on all the sidewalks. There were cars on all the pedestrian crossing. There, Freedom from communism was a right to park everywhere and don't pay anything. And they have really understood that, and they were very happy about that. And they used it very intensively. And the result was that there were no people around anymore. There are many great stories of Moscow being a great city, and you walked up and down and you saw no people enjoying the greatness because that had evaporated. It was a big parking space, Moscow. This is Main Street, Moscow, 5 years ago. Because there was too few car parking, then cars were allowed to park on sidewalk on Main Street, Tverskaya in Moscow. And also there were icicles hanging from all the buildings. So left were 1 meter for the pedestrians on Main Street, Moscow. Have a nice trip in Moscow. The air was full of advertisements, and so this was Moscow. Then they, long story made short, I gave a talk in Montreal about how we have changed cities around the world. And then this man came running up and say, "I'm the deputy mayor of Moscow. When can you come? We need you. We need to humanize Moscow. We have 12 months. Wow. And said, we can start on Monday. And then I went with some of our team to Moscow, and they said, "How many books have you written?" "Yeah, I've written 6. "Oh, we'll translate them all." Actually, I've only written 5 that time. We translated, not all of them, because some of them are very local, but 3 of them, they translated in 3 months. They are all translated and published by the city of Moscow. The man who is not so happy in the corner is a Danish ambassador. And then, after they published all the books in Russian, they commissioned us to make a survey of the life in Moscow. Street life, life in the streets, squares and parks. And that turned out to be a very easy task because the cars had almost killed all the activities. Only at the metro stations where there were a little bit of people steering, they came up of the hole and then they rushed down again. But we made this study and it has a lot of good ideas. Then in the middle of all this, I was invited up by the very big man, Mr. Sergei Sobyanin, the Lord Mayor of Moscow. And we had dinner and he said, "What will be in your report?" "Yeah, the idea of parking on the sidewalks on Main Street, Moscow, I don't think that's a very good idea. And I'll mention it in my report." 2 months later, I came back and there were no parking left on the sidewalks on Main Street, Moscow, because they have very efficient democracy. And actually, but that's another story. And if the Russians forgot about these new rules of parking, mayor had these little cars which moved around and picked up your car, and it disappeared. Rumor had it that the cars went to Siberia. And everybody knew that it must not be likely that you ever saw them again. Anyway, it became very quickly very respected, these new laws. Then I was back several times, but just a year and a half later, we started to see the outline of a miracle, which I call the miracle of Moscow. We had the old sidewalk, and I stood at exactly the same place a year and a half later. The gray street was beginning to be green. All the cars had disappeared. All the way through the main street, there were benches, and all the advertisements had disappeared. So now you could see Kremlin at the end of the street. In 1.5 years, it was a complete miracle, a gray street becoming green and more people friendly. And this was the beginning of a story, and I'll tell you a little bit more about it. Just push and push and push. Because this Moscow story is part of a bigger story of us, of me maybe, and me and my research team at the School of Architecture, and later on in the firm of Kehl Architects, that we have developed a number of methods how to study life in the cities. Because it is so that the traffic engineers, they've always had tools to study the traffic. So the traffic engineers, every city has a traffic department, and every city traffic department, they go out every day and count every year and count all the cars going this way and that way. They have curves, they have models, they have prognosis, and every time there is any planning problem, they tell the mayor, we need two more lanes here, two more lanes there, a little bit there, some parking here. They have the tools, but the people who looked after the people, they had no tools at all. So people were just sort of there while the car traffic was professionally organized. That gave a very, very big unbalance in all the cities of the world. So what we have been involved in from very early on was to make the people and the life in the cities visible, to have tools to find data about it. Because when you have data about the life, then you can tell the politicians what is going on and how it could be helped. And you can come back next year and see if it's better or worse. You suddenly can start to make policies and look closely into the situation. This is exactly what we have done in Moscow and in a number of other cities. But let's start now with the beginning of the lecture, starting now. Actually, not quite start now. We just end here by saying that this book, which we are publishing today here officially, is the latest book, and that is exactly the book about all the methods developed over 50 years on how to study life in the cities. Now comes the start. And the lecture is called From Jane Jacobs to Livable Vienna. Oh, to Livable Cities. Be more proud. And the first part of it would be something about a major problem all the planners and architects have fought with now for a long, long time. In the 20th century, we've had two major problems, two planning paradigms, which really have dominated everything. And both of them have been very much anti-human. One was the modernism. And if we study modernism, and I'm not trying to tell everything, though I know everything, but it started in the 20s and in the 30s, they made the essence chart of city planning. And Corbusier, he had all these diagrams saying, city is bad, what is good is freestanding buildings like this, and never make streets and squares because all bad things happen in streets and squares. There are barricades, there is a parliament of the streets, there are street girls and street boys. Don't do it, make grass. And have air and whatever, air and sun. And then this was a fantastic change in city planning. And I always say that it first started in earnest in 1960. It was around, it was not used during the war, and only a number of years later, when really the city starts to expand, the modernism was ready. It was also easy to mass produce modernism. So modernism became the way we did our city plans, our site plans, our architecture, and our Wohnungen. They were all done, Wohnung für das Existenzminimum, and all that. What really happened in 1960, that was a development of modernism. And I think that the expansion of the cities became so complicated and the new areas became so vast that literally the city planners went up in aeroplanes to be able to overlook everything, and they started the game of organizing the objects and pushing them around. Yeah, perfect. The side plans, the neighborhoods also became mechanistic and technocratic, whatever, and the planners and architects went up, I say, and looked at it from rooftop height. They went up in the helicopters and finally adjusted the neighborhood plans. But what happens in modernism was that this area, this level, this scale in planning was completely forgotten. Nobody was left down there to make sure that people had a good time, while all the planners and architects were up flying. And that this situation where nobody looked after this landscape was actually to have horrifying consequences for the life in the cities. Because everything you can think of which makes people not like to use a space, you can find done here. I call this way of planning the Brasilia syndrome. Brasilia, new capital of Brazil, was a competition 1955, and Brasilia is fantastic. It, from the airplane, it is, it's an eagle, and you, when you see it, you can see clearly it's an eagle with wings, and the head of the eagle is the parliament. Fantastic. And also down in the helicopter, going closer, you could see the buildings, the wonderful ministeries made by Niemeyer, lined up along the big central alley of Central Park. And everything was big, wonderful, and completely fine for architects and planners. But down where the people of Brasilia is, the Brasilia doesn't work at all. Nobody thought that there would be people in this city. And unfortunately, there has been now 4 million people, and they are still struggling with the good ideas of the modernist endless path, and they do all kinds of shortcuts in the grass. And so for the people, it's really shit. And they never realized that they would not have money to give them helicopters so they could enjoy their city. Brasilia syndrome. I take this along for the first time. I just found it. It's from 1972. I cut it out of a newspaper in Toronto, and that was one of the suburbs in Toronto was going to make a new city plan. And the planners, which was a big developer, he said, finally, my dream is coming through. Here is his dream. And he has said this to the architect, build it for the people. And this is what they built, a shopping center surrounded by 5,000 parking lots. Then all the corporate offices were in towers around it. Then a ring road and a freeway. And then all the poor people further out. No concern for the people, everything for the rationality. The city should be a machine. This is the conclusion of this little part of modernism. I don't think that if at any time in history a bunch of professionals were given money to do something which people didn't like, they could not have done better than following the rules of the modernists. This is a wonderful place. I found this bench here where you can invite your girlfriend to sit down, and then you can explain what a wonderful life we are going to have and see if she will marry you. Modernism. I'm not a great believer in modernism. The other big planning paradigm which has influenced planning enormously in the 20th century has been the car invasion. It came gradually. This is from Copenhagen, 1905. Everybody is walking as they please on the main street in Copenhagen. There is one car, no problem. one tram and one horse, two horses. But then a little bit later, there were more cars, and suddenly the cars arrived and people started to run away screaming. And then we have the third phase of car invasion, Moscow 2012. This is a typical 2012 Moscow pedestrian crossing, completely full of parked cars, where the Moscovites could train their slalom for the Winter Olympics to get across. So these two, especially this auto invasion, that came to be very, very influential, because all the cities did everything to make the cars happy. The more they came, the more they worked to make them happy, and all the cities generally forgot to make people happy. But also, it was the case that by 1960, when all this started, we knew absolutely virtually nothing about people in cities. All the knowledge, and there were a lot of knowledge in the old villages and medieval cities and in the old building traditions, they knew exactly what would make a good city and a good street and a good square, whatever. And that was handed from one generation to the next. Tradition ran the thing. The modernists, they said, we must throw out everything we know, because now we have not man, we have completely different species, modern man, and modern man cannot use anything which man could use. So we must throw everything we know out and start with new city planning, new everything. So all the knowledge about good cities was thrown out. So by 1960, when all this started to take off, there was virtually no knowledge about what the concerns for people would be. I have a very nice quote here from the mayor of Bogota, saying that it's a paradox that we know so much more about mountain gorillas and Siberian taugas and about good habitat for these species than we know about making good urban habitat for Homo sapiens. He was absolutely right. He is now back as mayor in Bogota, and we can hardly wait to see what he will do. Then in this situation, in 1961, there came this loud voice from Manhattan, actually from Greenwich Village, by Jane Jacobs, an architectural journalist, who wrote this book. And that was the first cry about, and what she really said was, if we let the modernists and the motorists make the planning, it's the end of the great American cities. We'll have dead cities. She also said, look out of the window, for God's sake. See how life really is, instead of speculating in all your offices about what people ought to do and what could be a rational way to do things. Look at how a sidewalk works. Look at the importance of the corner stores and the pubs and whatever. See, take your departure point from the people and the life, instead of hanging up in these machines. And now comes the story of my life, the shortest version possible. I was trained in the 50s in the School of Architecture in Copenhagen. And what did we train in the 50s? We were very good in putting objects. We really was good in bingo. This is a good city, wow. We learned this, and so we learned very much to be good modernists, and there was a lot of building being done, and we rushed out of School of Architecture, so did I, and should do all these fantastic things which we have trained to do. Then I married a psychologist, and that was a big shift in my life. Because she and the other psychologists, they kept saying, why are you architects not interested in people? Why don't they teach you anything about people in School of Architecture? Why do you think the professors go out at 4 o'clock in the morning and take photos? So they are sure there are no disturbing people in front of the buildings. And then, of course, I realized, and she realized, that we were brought up in two different ivory towers. The architects and planners were sitting here with all their theories and isms, and the social sciences were sitting here with all their knowledge. And we realized that between these two towers, there was a big void. But also we realized that whenever you did this game here, you manipulated with people's life. And we realized that nearly nothing was known about how you manipulated, what people liked, what they didn't like, how what would be a good place for people. Then I was forced to go back to School of Architecture for 40 more years to try to find out what they forgot to tell me in the first 5 years. And during this time, we had a number of students and research people, and gradually we started to get knowledge, to study painstakingly from the very bottom. What does people like? What does they don't like? Where do they assemble in cities? Where do they hate to go? And where? What do you do in the evening? And what do you do on Sundays? And what do you do when it rains? And in the winter, in Sahara, and in Greenland, and in the rainforest, because there are so many places where Homo sapiens live and their patterns. But then a number of patterns are very similar because it's the patterns of the species Homo sapiens. We have the same biological history, all of us. We have the same senses. We move in the same way. So there are so many similarities between Greenland and Australia and Japan and the Arab countries, South Africa, South America, whatever. All this we started to find out about, and books started to be published, and gradually there were more and more books, and I have been involved in 6 books, and at least they are out now in 75 versions and 35 languages. That doesn't tell about that it is fantastic knowledge, but it tells about that there was a huge need for this sort of knowledge worldwide. I've seen this very deliberately. So now, in 2017, I think we know quite a few things. There has been made studies over all these 50 years. Up top is the grandmother, godmother, Jane Jacobs and her book, and down here in the end is my book, Cities for People. It's because it's Birgitte who has placed it there. I never forget her really, but gave her really. No, but there are a number of studies made, so we could say that we know fairly well a number of things which influence people's life, and we know that that's a quote of Churchill which has been distorted, but first we shape the cities, but then they shape us. That the way we build the cities influence our way of life and a lot, and our the quality of life a lot. This knowledge, which have been gathered from scratch since the modernists threw out everything, much of it has been gathered by studying the old cities, because many of the old cities had qualities which the new cities had not. There we could learn something. But of course we found that there was a lot of principle which applies to city planning. Don't spread the people out, concentrate them, integrate, don't segregate. There's a number of rules you must obey in city planning to have a better city. And we know this now, that first you shape the cities, but then they shape us. There's a fantastic influence. But maybe primarily we found that it is in the people scale, in the small scale, the really battle for quality is lost or won. And we can take just an example here. The most famous square in the world is probably the Campo, the Piazza del Campo in Siena. Actually, Siena is famous because of a square. This square has been there for 700 years, and it's very nice, and it's full of people every day, still after 700 years. And then you can start to think, oh, this is a miracle. Or could it be common sense? Over the years, we have made a number of tools to study public spaces, people spaces. One of them is this keyword list of 12 items, what people would like to, what the questions are you should ask yourself when making a good people space. There's something about that you should be protected from all the bad things you can think about. If you're not protected, you won't come out. Then when you come out, it should be comfortable to be there. You should be able to do all the basics, to be able to walk, to sit, to see, to talk, to hear, all the basic things people do, you should be able to do. Plus, there's something about play and unfolding, whatever. And then the final line here is about enjoyment, and that is some of the nice things in the world which you can add. Human scale, very important. You should be able to enjoy the good parts of the climate. And that's different from every region to the next. And then finally, as number 12 in all this, is positive sense experiences. And only at this number 12 comes in architecture, design, materials, colors, birds, trees, water, views, and all these things. Many places around the world work wonderfully if the other things are all right, but if also the positive sense experiences are really looked after, then you have the most world-famous square or park or street in the world. So it's part of the whole thing. You have to do everything and then make sure that it also is beautifully done. In many schools of architecture over all the years, I've seen very commonly the belief that if you make the design and the aesthetics good enough, everything would be all right. It is not at all right. It is not that simple, my friends. You have to do much more work and then make it fantastically aesthetic. If you go back to the Siena Square and take this list and go in there, whoop, you found that in each of the 12, you have a big, yeah, wow, yes, indeed, 12 times, fantastic. That's why it's number one in the world. It's a rather seldom combination. You may ask me if I know of places where there are fewer of these things observed. Yes, I know of some. I know even of some places where out of 12 quality criteria, they've overlooked 13. And what is the result? There are no people. And if there are people, they run as fast as they can to get out. We have such a square in Copenhagen, I'll not mention it, because the ambassador is here. And people always say, why could you do this in Copenhagen? We say it's made by some people from Finland. But that's not completely true, but it doesn't work. 13 things have been overlooked. Never do that. Then, as years go by, we've also started to compile all we know in books. This book is, we had over the years, we had a very, very nice and very generous foundation for the built environment who always came over to the university and say, Jan, we think it's good stuff what you are doing. Do you have enough money? And then they took out their big, and they would you like some more millions to your work? And generally we said, yeah. So we had PhDs and we had this research center and they were very, and then I left the School of Architecture because I was too old. And then I thought, now I'm in peace. But then they came again and said, Jan, couldn't you sit down and write a book about everything you know while you can still remember it? And then I said, no, I'm too busy. I'm working here and there. Isn't that a matter of how many assistants we can give you to help you with this book? And suddenly I had time And we made the book. We made the book Städte für Menschen, which is now out in 33 languages. The latest is Macedonian. I'm going down there in a week, 2 weeks time, to help them to launch the Macedonian version after we did the Serbian version a little bit ago. And Albania is coming up, and Kosovo, and Thailand, and Malaysia, and Mongolia. It's fantastic. And what does this show? To me, it shows that there is an enormous interest in Städte für Menschen over the whole world, and we have been starved of information about how to do it. That's why so many people are interested in this. And now, then, we are into the next, because Städte für Menschen was about what do we know? But then the foundation came back and said, hey, Jan, now you've written what we do know. Now you must write how you found out about it. What are the messages so that the next generation can use the messages and we can embed in the city planning departments around the world that they must watch the people as carefully as they always have watched the automobile, make sure that people are just as happy as any automobile. And the interest we found of all this is also shown in another way. We've had this company in 15 years, and we have worked in cities from one end of the world to the other. All the places they demand to have people-friendly, humanistic city planning, showing that there's great need and has been a great lack of information and tradition for doing this. But also, at this point, we have distinctly a new planning paradigm. I think the planning paradigm shift is also because that we, after a while, after all these years of research, we know more, so we have been able to formulate and show that you can influence this and that. And now, if you ask the mayors of the world, would you like a livable, sustainable, and healthy city, they'll all say, that's my program. How could you know this is my program? We compete in making livable cities, that is, cities of with quality of life, and we must do something with the sustainability issue and the health I shall return to. The first thing about livability, I'll not do much, but saying that we grow older and older, we have more and more leisure time, we live more and more scattered, we have smaller and smaller households, we spend more and more time with all kinds of digital stuff. But that doesn't take away the very fundamental human interest in other people. You have a fantastic interest in seeing other people, sitting next to them at the lecture hall instead of sitting back home with your iPhone and get a lecture in there. Because after the lecture, you go out and have coffee and whatever you have. And it's all part of life. The greatest interest of people actually is life. The greatest attraction in the city is that there's life in the city. So meeting city as a meeting place, the meeting of people, that's the number one interest in the human life of all. And any type of digital stuff has not made that redundant. On the contrary, I think that the more people know about what is out there, the more they are interested in experiencing things also themselves. We've seen an upsurge in the use of public spaces in all the last 30 years. Another new driver for this concern for people in the city has been the concern for the climate. And it's been realized, of course, that if we can have people walk more and bicycle more and drive less, that will help a lot. And also we know that to get less driving, we need to have alternatives. And again, good public transportation, which I see as absolutely the future of mobility in cities, that it can be linked closely to good public realm. You have to be able to walk and bicycle down to the station and the bus stop in comfort, enjoyment around the 24 hours of the day and the 360 days of the year. We've got very important new challenges challenge. That is what my daughter, who is a doctor, but many other doctors actually, they call it the sitting syndrome. And they say, you planners, you have made cities now for 50 years which invite people to not move a muscle, but to sit on their behind every day from morning till night and do everything sitting. And then they point out that it is extremely expensive for society because all these guys, it's not the matter that they are fat, but it's the problem that they don't move. And I even know that if you're very fat and move a lot, you have no problem. If you're very thin and doesn't move, you are in for it. And that is something about circulation and heart and diabetes. And also they found now that there's a strong relation between not moving and cancer. So that's why we have strong, as city planners, we have strong orders now to make cities so that people naturally walk and bike as much as possible. That's the cheapest health policy any society can adopt. And actually, I've also been told it's something about that you should do 1 hour of moderate activity a day. I know for myself, I shall do 10,000 steps every day. And keeps the doctor away. And that is not a very big, but that could give you 7 extra years of life. And that could give you a much better period when you're old, much fewer pills, fewer tours to the hospital and the doctor, and generally a longer life and much better quality of life. And much cheaper for society, for God's sake. And that's why we've been ordered to make cities so that people walk and bike as much as possible. And if we take a closer look at this new paradigm of city planning, livable, sustainable, healthy, we can realize that if we are very friendly to people, pedestrians, public life, and bicyclists, we actually address all three issues here. So we have a lot of knowledge now, and we have a lot of reasons to do it. What do we do? Yeah, we have established a tradition of working very carefully with the quality in the existing cities. Are there any cities who have policy that here in this city we shall walk and bike as much as possible? Yes, there are more and more of those. One of them, which is really upfront, is our hometown of Copenhagen. And it started already in the 1960s. They closed the first streets. There were great protests that Danes would never behave like South Europeans. We will never use public space. We'll never go promenade or anything. Then we cleared the streets, and next year we started to be Italians. And it's become more and more Italian the more leisure time we have and the more global warming we have. So we've seen this development. Also, Copenhagen became the first city in the world where the life in the city was carefully studied with intervals, so it was possible to inform the politicians about what were the product of their improvements in the city. And these informations, they came to influence the planning of Copenhagen very much. When I retired as a professor, I got this nice letter from the mayor saying, if you guys in university had not studied people and documented the life so carefully, we politicians would never have dared to make Copenhagen the most livable city in the world. So they say, because of this information, they were able and they had courage to do a number of things, because there will always be some people saying, oh, you're taking our parking lots and you're taking chasing the customers away. But we could time after time prove that there were more and more people, there were better turnover, there were a lot of things going on in the city, and the politicians just had the courage to go on. So Copenhagen was the first. This is now the method which is used in many, many cities, actually getting as much knowledge about the people as the traffic engineers always had about the traffic. Here is a little map of Copenhagen, 1962, one little 1 kilometer long pedestrian street. This is the same part of the city today, and all the bases which have been addressed and improved and made people friendly in various ways. Copenhagen has by now a quite fantastic network of nice places for bicycles and nice places for pedestrians and public life. And I'll not go much into it, but just because I think it's interesting to see how these changes follow the changes in society. In Copenhagen, we can clearly see that the first 20 years focus was on walking, on promenading, and on helping the businesses so that Sydney could be a shopping center. But then the next 20 years, increasingly people were not so interested in shopping. They got more and more interested in also in sitting and enjoying and having culture in the public spaces. Tourism had started, and tourists, they don't walk all the time. They like to sit. And also the Danes have started to travel and see nice places. When they came home to their city, they say, we want a nice place here also, please. And they knew that nice place is about drinking cappuccino all day. So in the 80s and 90s, we saw the cappuccino culture spread all over the world. One of the biggest cafes I've seen outdoors is in Iceland. The third phase, which we're in now, is that new public spaces are increasingly geared to inspire people to bicycle, to run, to do roller skating, or to exercise. And also the architects are more wild now and make more funny spaces. And swimming in the harbor has become possible and celebrated because the harbor is now so clean that you can swim in the harbor. The most recent stage, and that's where we are in now, is from 2009, where the city council decided that not only the city center, but their whole city should be looked after carefully to be made a good city for people. And they had this strategy, we will be the best city for people in the world. And now they are carrying that out in all parts of the city, taking away traffic lanes, putting in more and more bicycle lanes and widening the sidewalks, whatever they do. They especially widen the sidewalks on the sunny side of streets so that they know that there is where people will take their chairs and whatever, cappuccino out and have a good time. We have no time for that. It's just a little bit of an overview. And I should not take the time from you, dear Birgitte. I would never do that. No. I could tell you a lot about Melbourne. I've been working, or first I, then Gil Architects, we've been working in Melbourne in 25 years. And they are the city which has done the most fantastic turnaround. Of course, it took 25 years, while in Moscow it took 3. But they have a more complicated democracy in Melbourne. but they have done miracles. Melbourne now is by far the nicest city in the Southern Hemisphere. Melbourne now has an atmosphere like Paris. Melbourne has brought back 10 times as many people to live in the city center as 15 years ago. They have expanded their tram program. You name it, they have done it. I cannot go into detail. I can only give you a general recommendation, if you don't know what to do, move to Melbourne. I always love to go to South America and go to Montevideo and Sao Paulo and say, why is Melbourne the most livable city on the Southern Hemisphere? Why isn't it Montevideo or Buenos Aires or Sao Paulo? Why can't you put your acts together as they could? Because they really have put the act together. Go there and see yourself. Move to Melbourne. I could tell you a lot about also our work. We worked in Sydney. We are still working in Sydney. Actually, next work, I'll be in Sydney working with them. And We worked in actually in all Australian cities and all cities in New Zealand. We have organized a city plan, which makes a Dane very proud that they're all doing Danish city planning down there. Except, of course, the capital, Canberra. That's made by some people in Chicago, and it's too big and too... I'm very happy that they never asked us to improve it. But then we worked on London, and then when they heard about this in New York, and they had this plan to make New York the most sustainable metropole in the world, they came and said, couldn't you come and help us with this? And they sent over to Copenhagen the planning mayor and the transport mayor, and they spent 48 hours in Copenhagen. They were on the bicycles all the time, and it was some good days, and every time we came around the corner, there were another 1,000 happy people sitting outside in the most wonderful places. And in the evening, we said to these American girls who are not voting for Trump, but we said to them, can we have the bicycles back during the night? No, no, no. So they kept them in the airport. We got them back, and they said, we want a city like this one. When can you come? I said, Monday. And then we went to New York, and again, a long story. It was in 2008 we started, and in 2013, Mayor Bloomberg's time ended, and he had made almost 1,000 kilometers of bicycle lanes, and he had made 50 fantastic public spaces. And they had a very big program of trying to prevent commuting into Manhattan and improve the number of people who took the metro, the number of people who took the bicycle, the number of people who used the sidewalks to do more exercise. And they've done a fantastic job. Not to go into detail, I just say that one of the things we were involved in were studying. They had no really public spaces in New York at that time. I don't think they had any, almost none, no cafes outside and no benches. If you were tired, you could go down in Central Park. That was a wonderful park, 8 kilometers that way. But it was realized that maybe we needed a Champs-Élysées in New York. And maybe we needed some good public spaces. And then we started to investigate where could we find them. Then he started the idea, maybe you don't need Broadway so much. Broadway is running parallel to all the avenues, but in a funny angle, and is a leftover from the Indian time, the Indian American. And it crossed the avenues in funny angles, and every time there were problems with the traffic and with the safety. Then they studied very carefully for a full year if they could do without Broadway. They came out and said, yes, we don't need Broadway for traffic. Actually, the traffic will run faster if we don't have Broadway. And all the traffic engineers said, fine, fine, let's get rid of Broadway and move faster. So we got rid of Broadway. That means that all the places where we had these crossings are now public spaces. Times Square, Herald Square, Union Square, Madison Square, and here is Times Square. And are you mentioning Times Square?
Just a little bit,
but we hear about Times Square later. But this is the beginning of 2009. This is later in 2009. It was a fantastic success right away. And the mayor had said to get it done, it's only an experiment. Half an hour later, he said, an experiment? No way, it's the biggest success in American city planning since Jane Jacobs' time. And it was the first time Jane Jacobs' ideas returned in force to New York. It took 50 years. They are now elaborating on the topic. This is the front cover of the New Yorker, saying that maybe we can even more recreation on Times Square to bring in the prairie and the buffalo and the home on the range and Jean Jacobs is sitting in her sky, jiggling. Return to Moscow. I was back again this year. There was a little pause because of Ukraine and Crimea. They didn't like people from European Union, and we didn't like them. I liked the work in Moscow more than they liked to work with Europeans. But I was invited back this spring, and then I saw a fantastic change in Moscow. It was full of streets which looked like this 5 years ago, 4 years ago, and now were completely changed. And I'll not go into this, but we had just been there last week, and where all the sidewalks were full of parked cars 5 years ago, we didn't see a single car on the sidewalk now. So the efficient democracy has been at work, and they have got parking rules, they pay parking fees, and they... Oh, I met a monument of Corbusier and had the pleasure to go up to him and say, there was something you didn't thought about with that modernism. But these are some of the new streets in Moscow where there are bicycle lanes, there are wide streets, there are bicycle features, there are parking rules, and they've started the bicycling in Moscow. It's not that every day. It's more like this, but it's coming. So in Moscow, we've seen a fantastic turnaround, and all the advertisements which were ruining the visual landscape in all the parks and streets disappeared. I don't think it was very popular to take it down, but down they were taken, and it's much better for it. And now, lo and behold, the big man, Sergei Sobyanin, he is traveling around talking about the importance of making livable spaces. We have come a long way since Jane Jacobs, and there are so many cities now who are urged. This is a mayor of Vilnius showing, I don't like you to park in my bicycle lanes. Don't do it. So, from Jane Jacobs in 1961 to Moscow in 2013, there's really been a substantial movement. Now, I was supposed to stop, and everybody hope I will, but I will not. Because I've shown you what is being done with all this knowledge which we have developed, which we have digged up in the 50 years. Where is it not used? Yeah, I can cry my aid here, the knowledge. And you can see that when it comes to repairing the old cities and cleaning up after the automobiles, we use these tools. And that's mostly because the citizens demand better conditions for people. But when it comes to new towns and new settlements, then we can still see a fantastic area where these tools are practically not used. All my books, and I'm proud of this, are published in China. I know they are widely, I've signed them all. I'm crying my eyes out every night. They don't use them. They have not had time to read them over there. It still looks like this. They have the knowledge, but they don't use it. People never liked the modernist and their way of building. There are so many signs of this. And still, it's going on with this way of building. In Dubai is a perfect example of all this. And you still have, and I'm very critical of this, what I call the bird shit architects flying in and dropping their towers. And they still have this idea that if they make enough towers, they may have a city. They won't. They will have a collection of perfume bottles. So, Dubai is modernism and motorism in a very clear form. And I can ask, is this what we can do for mankind in 2017? I know we can do much more. But still, there are great areas where this knowledge is not used to make better places. Singapore, is this what we can do for mankind? 2017. Just last week, I went around with Birgitte in the suburbs of Moscow, and constantly we ask ourselves, when we saw all this, is this what we can do for mankind in 2017? There was not a single sign that this knowledge is being used in all these new constructions. This is a brand new town being made on the bank of I think it was Donau in Belgrade, made by some developers from Dubai with city planners imported from America. Great modernism and motorism. Is this what we can do for mankind? 2017. This is slum clearance in Mumbai in India. Is this what we can do for mankind in 2017? Especially in the developing countries, I think these humanistic city planning principles, they are very cheap and they are very easy to apply, and they really could be for the benefit of a great number of people. Then these things are happening. Welcome to London. Is this what we can do in 2017? Welcome to Eurolil from Trem Koolhaas. Is this what we can do for mankind in 2017? Welcome to Copenhagen, to Ørsted, Newtown, Copenhagen. It's in the rush hour, as you get that three people. Is this what we can do with sense of human scale in 2017? No. Whenever there any restaurant owner who make a restaurant, he know exactly a lot of things should be done in people scale, down where people are, or people will not come and drink his coffee and eat his food. All the restaurants know it. Those who don't know it, they go broke. All the owners of resort hotels know that they must make the human landscape very attractive so that it would be a wonderful hotel and he'll have some guests. All the amusement parks in the world, the Disneylands and the Legolands and Tivoli Gardens in Copenhagen, they know exactly how to make a very attractive human landscape. It looks shit from the airplane, but that's not the point. It looks fantastic when you're down there and go around enjoying the narrowness, the human scale, the spaces. There are luckily exemptions from the rule. There are places where these tools are being used. This is a new housing area in Copenhagen where really many of the tools are being used. Here are some details from that particular area, inspired very much from Amsterdam and Holland. And then there are one place where nearly everything is in order, and I think that's one of the best housing schemes in Europe. It's in Malmö, on the harbor in Malmö, and actually nearly everything you can ask for is looked after there. And the scale is very fine, and the wind is taken care of, and all the details in the human landscape. And if we take this list of quality criteria and go to this particular housing area, we find that for every 12 of them, you can say resounding, yeah. And that's why I say, if you come to Copenhagen and ask for the best housing area in Copenhagen, I say, just go over this bridge to Sweden and turn left. There it is. But it is now 15 years old. And still, we are actually in the office. We are baking a book called Great New Towns of the 21st Century. It's the thinnest book in the world. We have been all over looking for fantastic new towns, and there are so few of them. And all these tools we have, and it pains me a lot that they are used greatly in the existing cities and so little by my colleagues, the architects, the planners, the developers in the new towns. We are going to build as much in the next 20 years as we built until now, or something like that. So we better use the tools we have to make all these new city fabric humane. welcoming for people. Thank you very much. I know it's not easy for Birgitte, but stand up, Birgitte.
Yes.
Birgitte, she is a PhD student of mine. And this book here, with my name and Birgitte's name, do you think I wrote it? No. Birgitte wrote most of it. And she is a very, very skillful and valuable member of our team and is gaining more and more experience. And it's been a pleasure to work with you on this book and on a number of other projects of this type.
Same to you, Jan.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Perfect. Thank you. Thank you so much. I don't know, should we wait with the questions for afterwards? I'll try to make it as quick as possible, and then I can just move, yeah, I'll move on. I'll dive into it.
You want to have signed until midnight.
Okay, so I will just tell you a little bit more about this book that I had the pleasure to write with Jan Gill, and it's also a great pleasure to be here today and launch the German version, Leben in Städten, here in Vienna. So I will try to make it short so you can also get a little bit of air. Humans need that, we know that for sure. And give you a little bit of a historic perspective. You already got some of it from Jan, so I'll just go through it quite quickly. And then I will give you some examples of the tools and also examples of how they've been used. So the overview, and here you can see also the Russian version at the end, and you can even see it. The other one was a small Danish lesson for you, so here you have all the versions. And we were quite surprised of the interest for this book with tools, that it wasn't just among students and really committed people, but also a broad interest also from politicians, because as Jan said, there's really this urge to have the knowledge out there, but also the tools to take actions. We all have these plans, these visions, it's going to be livable, sustainable, but realizing it's a different mission, it's harder said than done. Oh, sorry, harder than, you know what I mean. And then the overview of the different books. I will not go too much into details, but it's interesting to see the development. In 2000, new city spaces came out. There was an increasing interest in public spaces in many cities. Barcelona and Lyon, some of these cities really went forward and created great new city spaces, but also many others. The examples are collected in this best practice book. New City Life, documenting the changes of how we go about in the cities, not only shopping, but also doing a lot of recreative activities. And then finally, Cities for People, with all these examples from the world. And then the toolbook from 2013, it came out in the first version in English and Danish. Not too many details, but just an overview to see how it's interesting to look at the printing history of the first classic book on this theme, the first book from Jan's hand in 71, Life Between Buildings. It had a little bit of a slow life in the beginning, and then you can see over the years that it comes out in more and more versions, and now it's out in many versions, in many languages, but it wasn't until, if you look carefully up there, until around 2000 that it actually kind of exploded. Due to the societal changes, the climate change, all of that that we heard about, there was this need to also address these issues to make more people-friendly, more sustainable and healthy cities. And the same, if we look at this printing history, how it also turns into a strategic tool, how it turns into something in this competition that we also heard Anton address in his framing of the talk, how cities compete more and more. They know they have to do something, and they see the burning platform. If we don't do anything,
we'll lose to the other cities or the other city regions. So it's not only to be nice to people. But then also, if you look carefully, not only at the right bottom, but a bit further up, you can also see that we also have new tools. This is a book with GPS tracking, so we also gain new knowledge, but also new tools to monitor and learn more about human beings and how they interact with the built environment. And if we look at it in not only a historic perspective, but also in a geographic perspective, there are almost like different schools, a Copenhagen school and a New York school with Jane Jacobs as this mother figure, William White, another author, Project for Public Spaces in New York, but also on the West Coast in the US, in Berkeley. We have a lot of voices, a lot of authors, but mainly within the universities, but also different voices. Some are addressing somebody like Claire Cooper-Marcus, the needs of children and women in particularly, but also addressing the streets. Somebody like Alan Jacobs has addressed that in more detail. So a broader field, and Jan already mentioned that, but also almost like schools in Berkeley, in New York, but also in Copenhagen, where you find Jan, but also other good colleagues. And then the studies of public space and public life over the years, documenting systematically and gaining that knowledge about how we use the cities. And this is basically what it's all about, to be able to be in a meeting room and not only have a hunch when you're there with the traffic engineer, but also being able to bring data to the table about how human beings use the cities and how we can inform design, make it better for people so it actually fits their needs and also the development of needs over time. It's a different approach. This is, so to speak, the order: life first, then the spaces, and then the buildings. And then how is the reality? Well, quite often we have maybe a mayor who have seen that in the other city they had this fantastic architect come in and do this masterpiece. Now everybody is coming to the city, so ein Ding müssen wir auch haben. And then they call the architect and have them come in and plunk it down and so forth, and then wait for happiness. And, or it could also be a traffic system, a metro system. But really, we need to step back and look at the program. What is it we want? Who are we planning for? How is it going to be on a Tuesday evening when somebody walk home to their home from the metro and so on? Really those eye-level questions, the detailing, but also the bigger questions. What kind of city is it we want? For whom is it? Is it for everybody? And so on. So start with the bigger questions, the program, the things that are maybe not so sexy, not, you know, drawing fantastic architectural pieces, but really the basic questions: who is it for? How is it going to work over time, and so on. And then the tools that we present in the book, and really these are very accessible tools. Everybody can go out, despite the discipline and so on, to do observations of how people use the existing spaces, to count people and so on. And I'll just give you a quick introduction to some of them. And as you can see, we've selected 8 ways of going out to study public life, 8 ways of observing public life and public spaces, to ask those basic questions: who, what, where are they doing it? So first one, counting, understanding over time. That can be comparing weekend to weekdays. How are people actually using the spaces? That what's what we have been doing in a lot of these public space, public life studies. Understand the rhythm of public life, understanding the differences between the streets. Is this only going on in one street, or is there also something going on in the side streets, the alleyways, and so on? Are we okay with that, or could we do it differently? So understanding the patterns of life, the movement patterns, but also questioning, like here in Bryan Park, they actually have a park officer. He has 2 of these clickers. You know, if you've been counting in a metro or on an airplane with those, He has one for women, another one for men. Then he walks around Bryant Park in New York. Every lunch break, he counts all the men, he counts all the women, and then he puts them into an Excel sheet, and he's done that for numerous years. I've seen those Excel sheets, and it's fantastic material. And the idea there is to say, well, the threshold is 52% women. If there are less than 52% women, something is wrong. We need to look into the program. Are we doing okay? We need to change things. So that's their documentation of how well they're performing in Bryant Park. Another study of age and gender in New York City, some of the material behind what Jan just showed you on Broadway, going out and monitoring how many women, how many men, and what about age groups? Are the elderly here, the children? And what we found is that if you look at the groups 65 plus and then the children, they only represent 10% out there. But if you look at the statistics, they should be 30%. And that's an equation that we find in a lot of cities, that the elderly, the children are missing. And then we can start to question, does it have to do with safety? What are the issues? Why are they not here? How can we then invite them to also be part of the public life? And then documenting the changes as they've done in Copenhagen, that when we do something, when they do these changes, more and more public spaces, invest in the square meters, that it also has an effect that people actually use it. And that's very important because we forget quite quickly how it was, both in terms of the photo documentation, but also in terms of the use that people, as you can see, use the spaces in the city of Copenhagen more and more. So when the square meters, when there are more and more square meters, is go like this in Copenhagen, there's also more and more use. It's somehow logic, but still really important, especially for politicians, to have this kind of documentation to be able to take the next step, to have the courage. And here's the quote Jan referred to before, the letter he got from the mayor for building and construction, giving the courage this systematic documentation of the public spaces and the use of them in Copenhagen to dare to take the next step in the administration and also within the politicians. So that was count. You can count everything. You can count how many people are smiling, how many people are turning their heads, and so on. You can count everything. You can also go out and plot where are people standing at different times of the year, different times of the day, and so on. And Jan Gehl and others did that. These are some of the early studies, and realized that people are mainly standing at the edges of people, buildings, for instance. So this is some of the basic information gathered around how we use the cities. You probably know it, we don't like to, if we walked into this room and there were nobody here, we wouldn't stand out in the middle of everything, we would find something and we would have our back covered. We like that to feel protected and so on. So basic human behavior also documented in these public life studies. Another study, not only the other one was from Copenhagen, this is one of the early ones, from Italy, learning about human behavior, how we interact, and all of this knowledge that was somehow forgotten. I won't dwell too long, but just another example. This one is from London. A public space, public life study was done in 2004, and it was documented that a lot of people were there at Oxford Circus, but there was also a lot of cluttering, a lot of obstacles. So it was really congestion on the sidewalks. And then you can see that quite a few years passed by. It was not like in Moscow, the quick changes, but 6 years before the design was changed here at Oxford Circus, so you can move more freely, you don't have all the obstacles, you have a more pleasant experience. So that was one side of thing, qualifying design, using those tools to qualify the design, but also that it was a different thing to talk about streets for people in 2004 in London. So this is about improving the hardware, the urban structures, but certainly also about our mindsets and how we organize things and how we address things. So that's also a huge change and a change that takes time, where we have to be patient. Everybody can go out with a piece of paper and see how are people actually moving about here. We may have a hunch, but to go down and really draw down the movement patterns give you information about how they actually use the spaces, where do they move about. And this is one example from Copenhagen, from the busiest train station in all of Denmark, called Nørreport. And you can see here the movement patterns were drawn before this redesign of the station, and that means that the white islands, where you had hardly any people moving about, that's where they placed the bicycle parking. And it works. So it's worth going there to see for yourself whether or not it works, but really simple and informing the design so it actually works at eye level. You can also go out and be more like a detective, not only, you know, do the movement patterns, but also track people, see how fast they walk, where do they go about. In the early days, in the 60s, Jan followed Mrs. Fabrin, I think she was called, and her son out here in a new development, where they could see that even though on the paper it seemed as a safe environment, a safe new neighborhood, there shouldn't be any traffic or accidents, because you had the pathways for the bicycles and pedestrians, you know all these areas, and then you have the streets where the car should go. But somehow there were quite a few accidents, so they wanted to learn more about how come. And this lady, Mrs. Fabrin, with her young son, as anybody else, of course, when she could see the kiosk or the grocery store over there, she wouldn't go up the pedestrian bridge and then over there and that long, she would also cross. She would follow her desire line, the quickest path possible. So that was also documented in this study, why it would work in theory and not in praxis. Look for traces, human activity. You can see one example here on the right-hand side from the School of Architecture in Copenhagen, and also see that, well, even architecture students are human beings. So even though it's nicely designed with grass and material and everything, when you can see the canteen over there, of course you take the shortcut. So why not use this knowledge and then integrate it into the design from the beginning? Photographing, documenting human life, also the small details, the nuances, how we like to be out there and look at other people, but also this example, that's William White, a study from the 80s of pocket parks in New York City, where he, you can see the lady encircled in the red circle. She goes into the pocket park, she sees out a chair, and then she moves it just a little bit, tiny little bit. And if you notice, it's not that it's into the sun or into the shade or anything like that. It's just because we like to decide for ourselves. So again, basic human behavior, understanding it better, and why it can be a good idea with flexible, movable furniture, but also how we can learn much more about how we can organize these things. Times Square, some of the background material, how it's good to look at places with fresh eyes. This was the equation for Times Square, the layout where you can see with red marked the 10 or 11% laid out for the pedestrians, and then the rest for the cars. And then you can put it on the table and start a more qualified dialogue where it's not about this opinion and different disciplines with their baggage, but really about, is this the kind of city we want, where it's like this, or do we want another equation? And that started, and now it's a different story, as you also saw. And I'm also just gonna show you the photos from New York, but also to underline the importance of photo documentation, that we remember to document these changes. And in New York, they've also been tremendously good to monitor before and after numbers of how is the retail doing before and after, how is it with the traffic flow. So it's not only nice images of people sitting on cafe chairs, it's also hard facts that they can actually use to back up these decisions. Keeping a diary, not only going into the numbers, the quantitative side of things, but also noting down the details, how are people using a front garden in these new developments, understanding it really better in details. I will not go into details with that, but also just going out there, as Jan said, not sitting in the office, not only looking at the plan from above and drawing, you know, is it going to be here or there, but actually going out to learn and experience what works, what doesn't work. Do test walks like this in Sydney to see and monitor how long are the waiting times. And as you can see of the percentages, at some places you wait half the time for a green light, and then you might start thinking, well, could I get there easily by car or something else? This is not a place where you're then invited as a pedestrian, where you're pampered, where you're the king of the city. It's more made for cars. So documenting these things, and then I just brought a few examples from Vienna, from an analysis we did almost a couple of years ago. Just snapshots of how it is right outside our doorstep, almost. Ringstraße, which we all know with the cultural heritage and so on, the buildings, the life going on here. But when we go out there and experience it at eye level and document it and start looking carefully into what kind of environment it is, how do we experience it, it might be a different story. Actually quite dominating traffic scenery. And also the paving, if we go to the inner city, it's a completely different story in terms of paving. Here it's more modest, one could say. And also quite low priority, again, to pedestrians. Things we see in a lot of places, but also right outside the doorstep. Confusing layout. Where am I? I'm not really, you know, you have to stop and think and figure out the system. You're not really sure. So, and also the connections, not only looking at the isolated places, but also looking at the connection. How does it connect to the core of the city, for instance, here? A little bit of a mess was the conclusion here. Could be done better. So just to say, to go out there, to have a look, to look at it with fresh eyes and use these tools to gather information about how it is, not in theory, not on the paper, not on the plan, but in real life, how do we experience it? And also put on these other hats. How about if I'm an elderly lady and so on? Could I also walk here with my niece, 5 years old, etc., etc.? The quality of the paving, not really as astonishing as the architecture. And again, high quality architecture, functions, rich history, cultural history and heritage, and then a different story when it comes to the public realm. But again, a story known in many cities because the public realm has for many years been not too high on the agenda. And also lack of opportunities to spend time. It might be nice, especially on a bit of a more sunny day here, but this could be greenery that could be used for much, many more activities. So just a few examples from here. And then finally, I wanted to address also the new opportunities that we have to go out and study public life with new devices, whether it's tracking on a phone, GPS, etc. There's really a lot we can do. But I just want to underline, this is an example from Melbourne where they monitor, as you can see, different streets 24/7. But still, it cannot replace that we are out there, that we learn, and we get so much more than just data, because what we get here is raw data, but really these questions, the thing about life, what is it, how does it work at eye level, the experience of it, is a completely different story. So we can do a lot with data, but really this thing about the program, the key questions, who is it for, how is it gonna work throughout the week, the year, and so on, we shouldn't forget. And this is the final slide from my part, and this is a quote from former mayor of City of Bristol in the UK, who reflects upon how these public life studies, it's no longer something that started within the walls of some universities in Copenhagen, in Berkeley, and so on. It's actually something which is out there and influences also major cities in the world, and how we need the tools in order for us to be able to change them into these livable, sustainable, healthy, and so on cities that we all want to create in the 21st century. So that was the final word from my part. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Jan. Thank you, Brigitte. So there's some time for questions, and I'm forced to say that we're going to sell the book, and Jan will going, and Brigitte will going to sign the books. So please feel free. So, any questions out there? Please. Do we need a microphone? Okay.
Thank you, first of all, for this very interesting lecture. I was wondering if you had an opinion on privately owned public spaces, and if you can compare them to publicly owned private spaces?
Yeah, it depends extremely much about the character of the privately owned spaces. There are lovely privately owned spaces owned by benevolent organizations or whatever, and then there are very harsh commercial private spaces where everything is forbidden except buying. The good thing about public spaces run by the public is that it's the city council who decides the rules, it's the police who looks after them, and they have a much wider range of what is allowed than most private owners will have. So there's much more diversity and democracy in real public life generally than in private public spaces, which are not so public most of the time.
Can I maybe just add a note on that? Because sometimes we also forget that when we talk about lively places, we tend also to forget, for instance, housing areas, that the semi-private or the private spaces can actually also add a lot. So that we also make really, really good private and semi-private, such as balconies, but also the front gardens at the ground floor are really important components in a neighborhood. So I think there are like a lot of in-between calculations or like typologies of spaces that each have their own, you know, rights, so to speak, and own characteristics important to take into account. Yeah.
Could you share us some experience with us in the negotiations with the city administrations about your work and about the importance of your work, if the administration is not convinced about that, that the city is for people?
No, sorry, could you just repeat? I didn't get the question.
Maybe the English you can speak, we cannot understand.
Okay.
No, we just didn't get the first part.
I would be interested in some skills in the negotiations with the administration of the city to convince them how important your work is and how important it is to point it out that the city is for the people.
Yeah.
I asked it because we have some similar developments here in Vienna, which is called Begegnungszone, which is not only in rich shopping areas, but also in small areas where people are living, and there it is more or less a mess how it is developed, and it's very difficult to bring it back to the people who are living there.
Yeah, I do think that there are by now so many examples of these. I called it making people visible and have some documentation about how it is used and maybe the shortcoming, and so that you will have to think about how it could be made better. I think that best practice from other cities is a very good tool and very convincing for mayors and city politicians. One thing is they could be convinced that they should do some work in this area. But this particular book also makes it possible that quite a bit of the collection of data can be made by NGOs and student groups and local planning officers, so you don't have to call in the cavalry every time. They can do it in Moscow and New York and London, but much work can be done locally. And that's why we wrote this book.
Can I? Yeah, I just want to add, I've experienced sometimes that it's also good to get new tools, so to speak, or new approaches. And for instance, the 12 quality criteria, I've experienced standing out on streets, like you mentioned, with the politician, with the planners from the different departments, and then start systematically to go on this neutral ground and talk about, is there a place to stay? Is it a human scale? And then you start to discuss, and you may have different opinions, and then you start also to understand your different positions and so on. So I think it's really also about introducing some tools, some new tools, some neutral ground where you can have this as a dialogue tool to then start a new discussion. At times it can work, yeah.
Maybe I should also mention that there is a certain aspect of having experts coming from a long distance away. We will normally say that the expert's importance is equivalent to the number of miles he have traveled to get there. And many cities scrupulously useless. They say, when you have come all the way from Europe, you must be very important. So all the ministers and prime ministers will be there, and all the journalists and the television stations. And the local politician, they're just saying, yeah, now. Certainly, everybody is looking at this problem. Down in Sydney, they call me the Danish icebreaker, because whenever they have a problem between the city and the state of New South Wales, they send message for me to come and talk to the Prime Minister and have him sign the act of the new tram line or something like that, because it's sometimes easier for an icebreaker from another place to have the politicians realize that you're way behind if you don't sign this, something like that, than if you have your own traffic engineer saying you should sign this. Ah, wonder if that's good enough. So there's also a sort of a game here. But you can have my business card.
That's exactly what I experienced in my special local situation. That is a game between the politicians and the people living there. Mm. And we already argued that there is no place for parking cars, and that should be more ambitious for the people going through, and the local politicians are saying, now we have to take more care about the car drivers. Mm. That's the final argument, and then they stop discussion. That's a pity. Mm. But if you give me a business card, I would be happy.
Some benchmarking, yeah.
I mean, there's also one thing to learn is that you have to say, I can start on Monday.
Yeah.
I have basically three brief questions. The first question is, what was the tiniest town you were working on? Because I think the most patterns you presented are good for big cities. And I'm pretty much sure that they are basically the same, but I would like to hear if you already worked in a small city. Mm. And then the second question is, what do you think about smart city?
Mm. Because thank you for that question.
I really believe, for example, we are coming from Salzburg. Now everybody talks about smart city, about self-driving cars, and I don't know, electric bus stops, and I don't know. And they forget about the basic stuff you tell us. And so I think there's a little bit of contradiction right now. Mm. Yeah, and the third question is, are you involved in the Newtown Institute. Probably should get that lecture there in Holland, because they are planning Newtowns all over the world. Thank you.
You take the Newtowns. You ask about Italian cities. My real start in all this was studying for half a year in Italy when I was a very young man with my wife. And we studied mostly, we studied both small and mostly medium cities, Lucca, Siena, later on Venice. But what I found in all this was this about human Homo sapiens, that their behavior was very identical in all the places, but there were enormous differences between a well-planned or well-designed old city and the new stuff lying next to it, or maybe the next city over, which was done on other principles. So the way the cities were done had enormous influence in how the Italians were Italians here or there. That was some of the very early revelations, that there in any place are good places and bad places. We better make the good places. Then about the smart cities, and thank for bringing that up. And the automatic cars. There was a little part of my lecture which I somehow forgot. There was five slides at the end. That is, and note it down. Peter Newman, Professor Peter Newman, TED Talk. Are we winning? That's from 2014. And he points out that automobile driving has peaked in the world. It's going down in the United States. It's going down in Australia. The consumption of oil for driving, whatever, is going down. Public transportation is growing all over the world very rapidly. And he say that actually there has been a peak, it's on its way down. And it ends up, I think that, here we are, that's the race in public transportation in the last 10 years. And then the next one is the prediction for the climate before this peak. And this is the newest prediction. The green line is the gross national product, the wealth, and the CO2 line is the yellow one. So you can see that, and his history is, we can see the light, and that's wonderful. And actually, he points out that the car driving in the United States now is on the level of 1996, 20 years ago, which is amazing. They have more cars, but they drive less, and they get more fat. But maybe they're more careful now. Then comes more about the smart. The other thing is, I've become very convinced that the car as such, as we know it here, is a very old technology. It's from Detroit in 1905, and it's splendid for the Wild West and for the farmlands out in Central America. But it's certainly not a good way of mobility in cities, and especially not in big cities. Go to Sao Paulo or Mexico City and you realize it's a stupid technology and mobility to give everyone four rubber wheels and say, try as best you can. They, in Mexico City, they spend 3.5 hours as an average to get to and from the city every day. What a fantastic waste of resources, waste of life. So automobiles is an outdated technology. The automatic cars, everybody is very hype about that one. And if you notice more clearly, it's mostly the automobile producers, because they can see if we can really sell that idea, we can sell 7 billion more gimmicks to the world's population. And other people say, when we have the automatic cars, we can have twice as many cars on the streets, no problem. with traffic jams, but great problems for quality of cities. So that's to me not an answer to any quality question. It's an answer to getting more gimmicks sold by the automobile industry. And much of the smart city is also something about getting gimmicks, producing gimmicks and getting gimmicks sold and getting people hype about getting all kinds of automatic things. I still is a very strong believer in Homo sapiens as a walking animal who kisses the same way he did thousands and thousands of years ago, and that we should look at Homo sapiens very closely when we develop our cities. We have a lot of experience.
Yes. Just the smart cities, I think it's really important with the values. I was part of a Danish set up national think tank by the government. And surprised, there were lawyers, there were technologists, specialists, and we ended up discussing values and things that could be on the one hand and on the other. And those debates about what is it we want with it is really what is lacking. I think the politicians found that our work was hard to use, but it's also really important that we have these discussions. As I see it, they are just merely tools, and they can be used for all kinds of purposes. Like Jan has his smartphone, and now is more conscious about walking and things like that. So I think we can use them in smart ways, certainly as tools. The same with these tools, they are tools, should be used, but really it's what we do with them that is the important thing. Then the new towns, we are
in Holland.
Well, we are not part of the new town, but I think it's very interesting. But I would just say, in regards to the smaller towns and so on, we work with really small cities. I've been in tiny Norwegian villages and so on, working with these issues. But there, I think it's really valuable to also have tools and to gather other planners, to do workshops, things like that, and not necessarily be out there fishing, but learning people how to fish themselves. So I think it is something that we can use on all levels. If we are out there and also in suburbs, it's also about not only the spaces in between the buildings, but also what is happening inside, where do we actually meet, and understanding that better and how we can use it for more. So when we work with the smaller cities, we have collected a lot of experience at the office and have noted it down in a small document called Less, More with Less. Because certainly I think that's also the future, where we have to be more conscious. What do we do then with what we have also in the smaller communities? Yeah?
The truth, the whole truth.
So thanks for the lecture, it's really inspiring. The only thing is that when we talk about cities and healthy cities, we talk a lot about the public space and the space outside. Mm-hmm. So if we treat the city as somehow isolated interior and the shared exterior as a public space, I think we also should think of what if the exterior is not climatically appealing? So what happens if the responsibility is not just the perspective how we design, but actually what we get as environmental conditions outside? So are there some studies dealing with the control over the exterior climatic or environmental conditions, which could then, you know, invite people more, even without the responsibility of the weather?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. We know a lot about the influence of climate on how people use spaces. And I work quite a bit in Greenland. I've had Greenlandic students and Iceland and in Australia with a lot of heat. And there are various climate conditions, and they have, all of the climates have an influence on how people use the cities and the places. And we have to study that carefully. And we have to, at least in this region and also where we live in Scandinavia, we can do a lot to make the climate much better by preventing to have more wind than we have in the first place, and also preventing to shade out the sun, which brings in the heat. So there's a number of sensible things you can do to make a better climate in nearly every place. In Australia, it could be much more cool, or in Arabia, in northern countries, it could be much more warm. We have places in Denmark where you have palms and fig trees and whatever, and actually the climate, these places are down in the south of Germany. They are 2,000 kilometers to the south of where they are, because in the old days they knew exactly how to prevent the wind and get the sun. Now we just see a lot of people putting up high-rise, which generate a lot of extra wind and a lot of extra shade, just to mention things. So many, many places, they aggravate the climate. But climate is extremely important. Then we can go to the American model, or the which has been at last many years. That is, let's glass over the city so we get rid of the climate. They have it in Calgary, they have it in Montreal, they have underground cities where they take this, all the shops downstairs, because then they don't have the bad days. I've been involved in finding out that it's about, I think, between 30 and 40 bad days a year. All the 320 other days are quite good. And they are also gone when you're underground or when you're in under glass. So it's really about being naturally, not using too many resources, but thinking carefully about what you are doing in each climate. Ta-da. Thank you for that question. You can see in my book, Cities for People, Städte für Menschen, that there is one demand, that is good climate at eye level, yeah, as a demand, and how you can work for that.
I think we have to finish, and I have to thank Birgitte and Jan for coming, and it was a great pleasure working with you. Thank you so much.
So, thank you.